Hare Krishna, dear devotees, please accept my humble obeisances, all glories to Srila Prabhupada. So today we will start a new pastime. We will start speaking about Krishna entering into Mathura. So that's a new series with Hare Krishna. So we read about the pastime of Govardhan Hill. Now we will read about Krishna going to Mathura. So let me share the screen. So probably you know this pastime, that this pastime happens when Akrura goes to Vrindavan and he gets Krishna, right? And he brings Krishna to Mathura with him. So let's read. So that's when Krishna is already entering to Mathura. So Akrura brought Krishna to Akrura went to Vrindavan. He put Krishna and Balaram into the chariot, right? And brought Krishna and Balaram to Mathura. So and then Akrura left Krishna in Mathura at the entrance of the city, and Akrura went away to, take care of his life, do his, whatever activities he had to do, whatever duties he had to do. So now Krishna is with the cowherd boys. They are entering Mathura. So let's read. So after Akrura's departure means after Akrura went away, right? For example, you go to the airport and then there is there arrivals, departure, right? Arrivals to one side, departure to another side. So arrival is when the plane comes and people get out of the plane. And departures is when you enter inside the plane and the plane goes, right? So after Akrura's departure, Lord Krishna, Balaram, and the cowherd boys entered Mathura to see the city. So they observed that the gate of Mathura, no, the gate is, the door of the city, right? So, like, the door is something that you put in your house. When you have something, outside of your house, usually you say a gate, not a door, like. So they observed that the gate of Mathura was made of first-class marble. So there is this marble. Marble is this stone, this white stone that they use in India a lot, right? If you go to the temples in India, you have this type of stone in the walls, in the floor, this white stone. This is marble. So the gate of Mathura was made of first-class marble, of stone. Well, very well constructed, right? Very well made. And the doors were made of pure gold. So in Mathura, people, they were very rich, right? They were making even the doors of the houses made out of gold. We can't even make, our watch made of gold nowadays. But at that time, they were so rich and they had so much gold that they could make even the door of the house out of gold, So they were very rich, right? So there were gorgeous orchards and gardens all around. So then we have here a few difficult words. So first word is gorgeous. Gorgeous is like velikalepta, very wonderful, very rich, very, wonderful. That's gorgeous. Gorgeous is like, it's like more than wonderful, really. Amazing. Orchards is a place where you plant flowers. So that's an orchards. And also this orchards and also gardens. So there was a lot of flowers and plants all around the city, right? So very beautiful city. So instead of going to Europe, we should go to Mathura, much better than Europe. In Europe, they don't have doors made out of gold, right? I don't see anyway. Maybe they have. I know that Putin have in his village, but in Europe, I don't think they have doors made out of gold. So Mathura is better than Europe. So we should go to Mathura, Haribo, not Europe. And the whole city was encircled by canals. So canals is when you make, it's like a river, but it's like an artificial river that you make a hole in the ground and then you put water, then becomes a canal. It's like, so in this case, the city was encircled by canals. So they made these holes around the city with water so people could not enter to protect the city against the enemy. So, in Europe, they use it to do that also. The castles in Europe, they would have water around the castle, right? They would have these canals around the castle. So this was to make it difficult for the enemies to invade the city, to attack the city. So the whole city was encircled by canals so that no enemy could enter very easily. So they saw that all the crossroads. So what is a crossroad? We know what is a road, right? Daroga, right? We have a road, but what is a crossroad? Why this difficult word? Crossroads is when you have two roads and they cross, they go like this, That's a crossroad. Is when you have the two roads crossing. So this is the crossroad, they're like the corner between the two roads. So all the crossroads, right? All these places where the two roads cross, they were decorated with gold, and there were copper and brass storehouses for stocking grain. So they put gold also to decorate the streets, right? Even in the streets they put gold, Haribo, if you had gold, you will not put the gold in the street, right? You would put in the in some very safe place, right? You will not put the gold in the middle of the street, right? Because someone can steal your gold if you put in the street, right? But in Mathura they had so much gold that they will just put the gold in the street and nobody will take it because everyone had so much gold that it's normal, no problem. And also they had storehouses for stocking grain. Storehouses, these very big places when you can put different products there, to protect, to store the product. So they had these big storehouses, big places to store grain, rice and dal and wheat and corn, all these grains that people were eating, they were stored in these storehouses. And these storehouses, they were made out of copper and brass. Copper is this metal that it's red and becomes green with time. Copper. In India, they used to make cups out of this copper, right? And then you have brass. Brass is the metal that they use to make caratalas, yellow. That's brass. Like, you make caratalas out of brass, and you make paraphernalia to worship the deities out of brass. It's this metal that is golden, but it's not gold. It's just, yellow, golden. That's brass. So they were using this copper and brass to make the storehouses. Okay, very interesting, right? Very rich people, right? So there were many rich men's houses, right? Many houses of rich people, all appearing symmetrical. What is symmetrical? Symmetrical is when they have, they're like straight. They're not like, no, the houses were like straight, well made, straight houses, symmetrical or symmetrical. They were not like this, So they were very beautiful houses, very well constructed houses, as if constructed by one engineer. The houses, they were all perfect, all very good, and now they were similar also, just like if the same person made all the houses, right? So, for example, nowadays, if you go to the street, you see that all the houses, they are all different, right? And doesn't look very beautiful, right? One is big, another is small, one is red, another is black, right? The houses, they are all different if you go to the street. So doesn't look so well, doesn't look so beautiful, right? But when the houses there are all similar, then it looks more beautiful, right? So that was the situation in Mathura. So are you following here? Are you understanding this part? So many words here. Yes, okay, so if you are understanding, we can continue because there are so many new words here because Prabhupada is describing many different things, right? So we have so many new words here. So a lot of words that we need to learn here if you want to understand this part. So the houses were decorated with costly jewels. So costly means, expensive jewels. So they had these jewels, these expensive jewels, and they were using to decorate the houses, to put outside the houses, to decorate the houses. So they had so many jewels. So jewels means like this, like necklace and earring and nose ring, these precious things, that expensive things that people use, right? Woman use. So they had so many of these jewels that they were using to decorate the houses. They were putting outside the house, in the door, in the window, in the tree. They had so many of these jewels that they were putting them everywhere, even in the door of the house. So the houses were decorated with costly jewels, and each and every house had nice compounds of trees, bearing fruits and flowers. So compound means like a garden. So they had these nice gardens of trees, and these trees, they had fruits and flowers. So very beautiful, very nice. And the corridors, corridors is a word that you have in Russian also, corridor, I think, right? Corridor, something like that in Russian. So it's the same word, right? It's just it's just pronounced a little bit different. So the corridors of the houses, and also the verandas. Verandas or varandas is this part that is outside the house, right? It's covered but it's open, so you can sit there, get some air. So that's varandas. So the corridors and varandas of the houses were decorated with silk clothes. So silk is this type of cloth of fabric that women like to use to make saris, and it's very expensive, very good and very expensive. So this is silk. So no, normally you use silk to make saris, to make very expensive clothes are made out of silk. But people in Mathura, they were putting the silks outside the houses, to decorate the houses. They had so much silk that they were just putting it everywhere. And also, so it was not only silk. This silk that they were using to decorate the house, it had embroidery. Embroidery is these details that you make, around the clothes. Also very expensive, No, you use needle to make these small details on the clothes. Embroidery work and jewels and pearls. So they had this very expensive silk with embroidery and jewels and pearls. And they were using to decorate their houses. They put in the window, in the wall, Imagine how rich they were, You can't use this type of silk even for sari. What you say about putting in the window, right? So, very rich people in Mathura. That's the city of Krishna. At that time, it was Kansa's city, but Krishna went there and killed Kansa, and now it's my city, right? So in the front of the balcony windows were pigeons and peacocks walking and cooing. Very difficult words here. So balcony windows are the windows that goes no for to outside of the houses. So there were birds in these windows, these pigeons and peacocks, you know, they were walking and you know chanting and so on. And all the grain dealers' shops in the cities, in the within the city, were decorated with different kinds of flowers and garlands, newly grown grass and pleasing flowers like narcissus and roses. So the grain dealers means the shops where they sell grains, like no, the shops where they sell rice and dal and other grains. So these shops, they were decorated with flowers and also garlands and newly grown grass. You know, this young grass that is green and beautiful, you know, looks beautiful also. And also pleasant flowers like roses and also this other flower called narcissus. So they had flowers, even in the shops, they had flowers and garlands. No, even the shops were beautiful. So if you go to the shops, you know, you go to the product shop, it's usually not very beautiful, right? But in Mathura, even the shops were beautiful. So very nice city. So like I said, instead of going to Europe, we should go to Mathura, right? Let's go to the city of Krishna. It's much more beautiful. So the entrance doors of the houses were decorated with water pots filled with water. So water pots is a pot that you use to put water, right? So that's a water pot. So for example, in India, sannyasis, they use it to carry these water pots with water. So now if they needed to drink water, they had some water to drink. So the entrance doors of the houses were decorated with water pots filled with water. So they had these pots with water in the entrance of the houses. And then also a mixture of water, yogurt, sandalwood pulp, and flowers was sprinkled all around the doors. So, you know, yogurt, sandalwood pulp, you know, these things, they are expensive. You know, try to buy yogurt in India, you know, you don't even find it, you know, to buy. And sandalwood pulp, you know how much sandalwood costs. You know, you buy a small piece of sandalwood like this, you know, and it costs like, I don't know, 200-300 rupees. One small piece like this, you know. And then you need to, you know, make it into a pulp. You know, you need to put in this stone and do like this to make the sandalwood pulp. And you know, it's very expensive. You know, sandalwood pulp. You know, sandalwood pulp is only for the deities. You know, nobody uses sandalwood pulp nowadays. It's very expensive, and yogurt also. But they would mix this yogurt with sandalwood pulp, and they would throw in the doors. You know. You know how rich they were, you know. So, and not only this, the doors, they were also decorated with burning lamps of different sizes. They had these ghee lamps on the doors, you know, like we used to make arati, they made just to put in the doors, just to decorate the doors. And all the doors were de and all the doors were I don't know, over all the doors were decorations of fresh mango leaves and silk festoons. So mango leaves, you know, this is these leaves from the mango tree, right? This and so they had this, they were using these leaves, and also silk festoons. Festoons is difficult to explain. It's something that you make. You also use is a decoration, is some big thing that you can make. Nowadays we make these things out of paper. So you make, you know, you use paper like this Chinese, they like to use these things. It's like a balloon made out of paper. That's a festoon. You usually put a candle inside, so it, you know, you have some light there. So, but there in Mathura, they were not using paper to make these festoons. They were using silk. You know, even these festoons they were making out of silk, you know, Haribo, you know, very rich people. So when the news spread that Krishna, Balaram, and the cowherd boys were within, no, inside Mathura city. All the inhabitants gathered. They all came together, and the ladies and girls immediately went up to the roofs of the houses to see them. So the ladies, they went to the top of the houses to see Krishna, because on the top of the house, you can see better, right? So all the ladies and girls, they went to the top of the houses to see Krishna. So they had been awaiting the arrival of Krishna and Balaram with great anxiety. They were waiting, Krishna, when Krishna is going to come? Ah, I want to see Krishna. All the ladies, they were like this, like when the Beatles appear, the ladies said, ah, so like this, Krishna appeared, and all the ladies, they were, ah, Krishna, they were all waiting for Krishna and Balaram. So they had been awaiting the arrival of Krishna and Balaram with great anxiety. And in their extreme eagerness to see Krishna and Balaram, the ladies did not dress themselves very properly. So the ladies, they were, ah, Krishna is coming. So they were so anxious to see Krishna that they would not dress very well. They would put the sari on the other way. They would put one earring. They would put earring here, but not here. And instead of putting the red dot here, they would put like here, and tilaka, they would put tilaka here and the red dot here, and no, they were not dressed very well, because they were rushing, they were running to see Krishna. So they would not dress, in very strange ways. They would not dress very properly. Some of them placed their clothes in the wrong place, and some anointed their eyes on one side only. So they would paint one eye, but the other eye they would forget to paint. And some wore ankle bells. Ankle bells is this, things that you put in your leg that make, a noise when you walk. This is called ankle bells. Ankle is this part of the leg, like this is the feet, and then here is the ankle in the leg. So some wore ankle bells only on one leg, or wore only one earring. So, only one earring, one ankle bell, because they were, running to see Krishna. Thus, in this way, in great haste. Haste means when you are very, when you hurry, when you are running, ah, terapit. This is haste, when you are running, trying to do things very quickly. This means haste. Thus, in great haste, not even decorated properly, they went to see Krishna from the roofs, from the top of the houses. So very, very interesting, right? So some of them had been taking their lunch. They were eating, right? Some of them, they were eating. But as soon as they heard that Krishna and Balaram were in the city, they left their eating and also ran to the roof, to the roofs. So now some of these ladies, they were there taking prasada, but when they heard that Krishna is coming, they immediately stopped at prasada and went to the roof to see Krishna. So some of them were in the bathroom taking their bath. Now they were taking bath, but without properly finishing their baths, they went to see Krishna and Balaram, right? So some of them, they were bathing, so they would not finish. They would have, soap in the hair, and they would just, put some sari very quickly and go to see Krishna. So they would go to see Krishna in the, with soap in the hair, because they were taking shower and did not finish. Only one earring, red dot here instead of here, and only one ankle bell, and no, they were so eager to see Krishna that they were not dressing very well. So some were engaging their children, so some were engaged in feeding their children with breast milk. Now, some of them were, giving milk to the babies, right? But they put their babies aside and went to see Krishna and Balaram. Poor babies. The babies were there, eating, drinking the milk of the mother, and the mother, stay away. I'm going to see Krishna now. So they won't even forget their babies to see Krishna. So, passing very slowly and smiling, Lord Krishna immediately stole their hearts. Because Krishna was now very slowly walking and smiling and looking, to all the ladies. And now the ladies, they fall in love with Krishna. They started loving Krishna. Now they become enchanted by Krishna. Krishna stole their hearts, That's a beautiful way to see that you fall in love. So Krishna stole my heart, So it means that I'm in love with Krishna. So he, Krishna, who is the husband of the goddess of fortune, passed through the street like an elephant. Right? So Krishna was very strong like this, like an elephant on the street, like this. Right? And Krishna is, of course, the husband of the goddess of fortune, right? So Krishna is very rich. So for a long time, the woman of Mathura had heard about Krishna and Balarama and their uncommon characteristics, and they were very much attracted and eager to see them. So these ladies, they were hearing about Krishna, no? They were hearing about Krishna's pastimes, and Krishna is so beautiful, Krishna is so wonderful. So they were hearing about the uncommon characteristics of Krishna, the uncommon qualities of Krishna, right? Because Krishna is not common, right? Not everyone is like Krishna, right? Only Krishna is like Krishna, right? So Krishna has uncommon characteristics. So there's this woman, the women, they were hearing about Krishna for a very long time, and they were very much attracted and eager to see Krishna and Balaram. They were, they wanted very much to see Krishna because they were attracted by Krishna, right? Now, when they finally saw Krishna and Balaram passing on the street and saw them sweetly smiling, no, smiling in a very sweet way, in a very beautiful way, the ladies' joy, the happiness of the ladies reached the point of ecstasy. So the ladies now, they are in ecstasy seeing Krishna. They're in ecstasy seeing Krishna. So when they actually saw them with their eyes, now when the ladies finally saw Krishna and Balaram with their eyes, they took Krishna and Balaram within their hearts and began to embrace them to their fullest desire. So they started embracing Krishna. They couldn't go to embrace Krishna in the street, right? So they were embracing Krishna inside their hearts. They took Krishna inside their hearts and they were embracing Krishna inside their hearts. Their bodily hairs stood up in ecstasy. So the hairs and the no the no when you become very strong emotion, sometimes the hairs they become like this, right? They become erect. So they become the hairs of the ladies become like this because of their ecstasy in seeing Krishna. So they had heard of Krishna, right? In the past, they heard of Krishna, but they had never seen Krishna, right? They heard about Krishna, but they never saw Krishna personally. And now their longing was relieved. Now finally, their desire of seeing Krishna was satisfied. Now they are finally seeing Krishna with their eyes. So After going up to the roofs of the palaces of Mathura, the ladies, their faces joyful means they were happy, right? Joyful means we're full of happiness. Joyful means full of joy or full of happiness. So they were very happy and they began to shower flowers upon Krishna and Balaram. They started throwing flowers into Krishna from the top of the palaces. So Krishna was walking in the street, like an elephant, and there was this rain of flowers falling into Krishna because the ladies were throwing these flowers from the top of the palaces. So, very beautiful scene, right? Krishna entering the city, and now the ladies there in the top of the palaces, and they are in ecstasy seeing Krishna, and they are throwing flowers and shouting, Krishna, Krishna, chanting Krishna's name. And Krishna is passing on the street, everyone is looking at Krishna, and flowers are falling on Krishna and so on. So when the brothers, Krishna and Balaram, were passing through the street, no, they were walking the street, all the Brahmanas in the neighborhood went out with sandal water and flowers and respectfully welcomed them to the city. So now the Brahmanas, they went to receive Krishna and Balaram. They had water and sandal. They had sandal mixed with water and also flowers. So they were receiving Krishna and Balaram, welcoming Krishna. Well, Krishna, please welcome to our city. We are so happy that you came here. So they all welcomed Krishna. And they welcomed them to the city. And all the residents of Mathura began to talk among themselves about the elevated and pious activities of the people of Vrindavan. So they started talking to each other about, no, these people of Vrindavan, they are so fortunate, they are so pious, because Krishna was living with them in Vrindavan, right? Krishna is visiting us in Mathura, but Krishna was living there in Vrindavan for so many years. So how pious, how wonderful, elevated these people of Vrindavan must be, right? So the people from Mathura, they were speaking about people of Vrindavan. So the residents of Mathura were surprised at the pious activities of the cowherd men in Vrindavan must have performed in their previous lives to be able to see Krishna and Balarama daily as cowherd boys. So people in Mathura, they were talking about people in Vrindavan and how these people in Vrindavan, how they are wonderful, how they are fortunate, how no, that Krishna was living there in Vrindavan with them, and they could see all these pastimes of Krishna and Balaram when they were children, when they were small, when they were cowherd boys. So that's what they were talking about. So while Krishna and Balarama were passing in this way, they saw a washerman and dyer of clothing. Krishna was pleased to ask him for some nice clothing. So they had this man in the street. So this man is a washerman. What is a washerman? A washerman is a man who washes clothes. You have so many clothes, and you pay some man to wash your clothes. So this man is the washerman, the man who washes the clothes. So the washerman, he goes to all the houses and collects the clothes and washes. And also dyer, he's also a dyer of clothes. This word dyer is a little bit strange. Probably you don't have any idea of what is a dyer of clothes. But this word dyer comes from the word dye. So to dye means to paint, right? So for example, you have a cloth that is white and you want to make this cloth yellow. So you can buy some special paint and you put the cloth in this paint. And then the cloth becomes yellow or red or green, any color you want, right? So that's a dye, it's a paint. To dye means to make it in a different color, to paint it in a different color. Usually use this word dye to clothes. So, for example, when you are going to paint a wall, normally you don't say, I'm going to dye my wall. You say, I'm going to paint my wall. But when you speak about clothes, normally it's a specific word that is used for clothes. When you are going to, make your clothes in a different color, usually you don't say, I'm going to paint my colors. You say, I'm going to dye my clothes. Right, so to dye means to paint clothes when you make the clothes in a different color. So this washerman, he was washing the clothes and he was also dyeing the clothes. So if you had some white sari and you wanted to make the sari green, you could ask, okay, you wash the sari and then you make the sari green. You dye this sari, make it green. So now, this washerman, he was probably making a lot of money, right? He had two jobs. Now, he was washing and he was dying. So, probably he had, I don't know, he was making some good money, right? So, they were passing in the city and they saw this washerman and dyer of clothing. And Krishna was pleased, Krishna was happy to ask him for some nice clothing. Right? Imagine that Krishna comes to your house and say, "Oh, Haribo, I came to visit you. Please give me some new clothes." No, we would be very happy, right? If Krishna would come to our houses and ask clothes, right? Would be a very big mercy, right? Krishna, you here in your door and like this, and oh, wait, I'm coming, And then you open your door, is Krishna is there, Ah, Haribo, Krishna, you are here in my house, And Krishna says, oh, please give me some clothes, some nice clothes. And yes. You won't go to get some, the best clothes to give to Krishna, right? So Krishna went to this washerman and he asked, oh, please give me some clothes, some nice clothes. And he also, so he also promised that if the washerman would deliver the nicest dyed clothes to him, the washerman would become very happy and now good fortune would be his. So Krishna said to this washerman, washerman, if you give me some nice clothes, nice dyed clothes means clothes that you painted, that you dyed, you are going to be very happy and you all God no all good for good fortune is going to be yours. You're going to be very rich and opulent, you're going to get all the blessings. So Haribo, very good opportunity, right? Krishna not only comes to your house and knocks in your house and he asks you to give some clothes, but he also wants to give you some blessings, right? Haribo, very good, right? Very fortunate. So Krishna was not a beggar, nor was he in need of clothing, right? Krishna is the husband of the goddess of fortune, Haribo, he doesn't need money, he doesn't need clothes, he has already everything. But by this request, request means to ask. By asking, in this way, he indicated that everyone should be ready to offer Krishna, to offer him whatever he wants, right? Krishna was teaching us that we should offer Krishna whatever he wants, right? And then we can be happy by doing in this way. So that's what we do when we have a deity, or when we visit the temple, right? We go and we bring some offering, right? So we should offer everything to Krishna. And Prabhupada says that this is the meaning of Krishna consciousness. That's what Krishna consciousness means, to offer things to Krishna. Whatever you have that is best, you should offer to Krishna. So unfortunately, this washerman was a servant of Kansa. Ah, problem, right? This washerman was serving Kansa, so actually this washerman is a demon. So this washerman was a servant of Kansa, and therefore could not appreciate the demand of Lord Krishna, the supreme personality of Godhead. So problem is that this washerman is a servant of Krishna, he's a demon. So he was not so happy when Krishna was asking him for clothes. He could not appreciate, the opportunity that was having. So Prabhupada explains, so Krishna went to this washerman, and instead of becoming happy that Krishna was there and wanted to give him blessings, this washerman became angry. Who is this Krishna? He didn't want to see Krishna. He became angry because he was a demon, right? So Prabhupada explains that this is the effect of bad association, right? Because he was associating with Kamsa and with other demons, he also became like them. He also became a demon. He was not happy to see Krishna. He could immediately deliver the clothing to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who promised him all good fortune, right? He could just have, yes, Krishna, I'm going to give you all the clothes that you want, right? Then Krishna would bless him, right? So he would be blessed. But he, instead of giving the clothes to Krishna, being a servant of Kamsa, the sinful demon could not accept the offer. The sinful demon could not agree to give clothes to Krishna. He said, "No, I'm not going to give you. Get away from here." So instead of being pleased, he was angry and refused the Lord's request. He said, "No, I'm not going to give you anything. Get out of here," to Krishna. And he said that, "How is that you are asking for clothing which is meant for the king?" Right? The washerman said, "These clothes are not for you, boy. They are for the king. They are for Kamsa." And the washerman then began to instruct Krishna and Balaram. He started chastising Krishna and Balaram. "Oh, who you think you are to ask these clothes? These clothes are not for you. These are for King Kamsa, My dear boys, in the future, don't be so impudent as to ask for things which belong to the king. Otherwise, you will be punished by the government men, by the police, by the people from the government. They will arrest you and punish you, and you will be in difficulty. I have practical experience of this fact. Anyone who unlawfully wants to use the king's property is very severely punished." So the washerman wanted to chastise Krishna and Balaram, to say that, "Oh, you want the clothes of the king? You are going to be punished by that. They are going to put you in jail. They are going to punish you if you take these clothes for King Kamsa." So the washerman was a very deep Maya, right? He was thinking that Krishna was just some normal boy from the village. So, on hearing this, Lord Krishna, the son of Devaki, became very angry at the washerman, and striking him with the upper portion of his hand, Krishna did like this, boom, on the washerman. Boom, he struck washerman with the upper portion of his hand. He separated the man's head from his body. So Krishna did like this, boom, on the washerman, and the head fell off. He separated the head from the body, so the boom, and the head just boom, fell off. The washerman died. So the washerman fell down on the ground. So the now Krishna just boom, and then the head of the washerman fell into the ground, boom, and the body also fell into the ground. In this way, Lord Krishna confirmed the statement of the Brahma Samhita. Krishna confirmed what the Brahma Samhita says, that every limb of his body is capable of doing everything he likes, right? So, without a sword, but simply with his hand, he cut off the head of the washerman. This is proof that the Supreme Lord is omnipotent. Omnipotent means that he can eat with his eyes, he can smell with his hand, he can do anything with any part of his body. This means omnipotent. He can do anything he wants. If he wants to do something, he can do it without extraneous help. With help. He doesn't need anyone else to do things. He can do himself. That's Krishna, right? So normally, if you want to cut someone's head, right? You want to cut someone's head. How you can cut someone's head? Only if you have a sword, right? If you have a sword and you know how to use the sword, you know, then boom, you can maybe cut someone's head, right? You can cut someone's head and the head falls with a sword, right? But without a sword, it's not possible, right, to do it. But Krishna, without a sword, just with his hands, he cut the head of this washerman. So this means Krishna is omnipotent. He can do anything he wants. So after this ghastly incident, after this terrible incident, you know, ghastly means like terrible, like ugly, because, you know, Krishna cut the head of this washerman and there was blood everywhere, you know, so it was ghastly. After this ghastly incident, but of course the washerman went back to Godhead, right? So that's the good part. So that's also good, right? The washerman was killed by Krishna and he went back to Godhead. So the washerman, anyway, he got mercy. So after this ghastly incident, the employees of the washerman immediately dispersed, leaving the clothing. So this washerman, he was kind of a rich washerman. So he had employees, he had people working for him. He was like the boss of the washerman. So there was many washermen who were working for this man. But they all dispersed. They all started running away. They become afraid that, oh, Krishna is going to kill me also. So they started running. And they left all the clothes. So they all run away and they left the clothes there. So Krishna and Balaram took possession of it. Krishna and Balaram took the clothes for themselves and dressed according to their choice, right? There were so many clothes there, so Krishna and Balaram and the cowherd boys, they just started taking whatever clothes they wanted and just started dressing, you know, according to their choice in the way they like it. So they started dressing with all these clothes from Kansa. And so Krishna and Balaram took possession of it and dressed according to their choice. The rest of the clothes were offered to the cowherd boys, who also used them as desired. So Krishna dressed, Balaram dressed, all the cowherd boys dressed, you know, everyone was happy. So what they did not use remained there. So they took whatever clothes they wanted, and you know, what they didn't want, they just left there in the street. So Krishna, Balaram, and the boys then proceeded along the main road. So they continued walking on the main road of the city, on the biggest road of the city. In the meantime, at the same time, right, a devoted tailor took the opportunity of service and prepared some nice clothes from the cloth for Krishna and Balaram. So there was this washerman who was a demon who did not want to give the clothes to Krishna, and Krishna, boom, cut his head, right? And the washerman went back to Godhead. And then there was also a tailor. A tailor is a person who makes clothes, takes needle and starts stitching and makes, you know, clothes. This is a tailor. So the tailor was a devotee. So this tailor, he took the opportunity of service. He wanted to serve Krishna and Balaram. So this tailor, he made some nice clothes for Krishna and Balaram and offered this cloth to Krishna. So thus being very nicely attired. Attired means he was dressed very nicely. Attired means, you know, the dress. So these are all, you know, you see that these are all very uncommon words that people that Prabhupada uses. For example, tailor, atirt. These are words that you don't use so much, but it's good to know, right? When you are reading Prabhupada's books, then you can know all these words. You don't need to write these words because these are not words that you are going to use very often. They're not common words, but you just hear and then you can learn some of these words, and then when you hear on Prabhupada's books, you can know. So Krishna and Balaram look at like elephants dressed with colored clothing on the full moon day of the dark moon day. So there is one day that there is some festival in India that they dress the elephants. So Krishna and Balaram, they look at like these dressed elephants. They look at means like they look at very beautiful and very strong and so on. Krishna was very much pleased with this tailor, right, with this man who made clothes for them, and gave him the benediction of Swarupya Mukti, which means that after leaving his body, he would be liberated and would attain a four-handed body exactly like that of Narayana in the Vaikuntha planets. So this tailor, he was blessed by Krishna to go to Vaikuntha and to get a body just like the body of Krishna in Vaikuntha with four hands. He would get the same form of Krishna in Vaikuntha. This is called Swarupya Mukti. And Krishna also blessed him that as long as he would live, he would earn sufficient opulence to be able to enjoy sense gratification. So Krishna said to this tailor that you, as long as you are living, you are going to be very rich. You are going to be very opulent. And after you leave your body, you are going to go to Vaikuntha and acquire a form just like mine in Vaikuntha. You are going to get a form with four hands in Vaikuntha. By this incident, Krishna proved that those who are Krishna conscious devotees will not be lacking material enjoyment of sense gratifications. They will have sufficient opportunity for such things, but after leaving this body, they will be allowed to enter the spiritual planets of Vaikuntha Loka or Krishna Loka, Goloka Vrindavan. So devotees normally they are happy here in this planet, and when they die, they go to Vaikuntha or to Goloka, right? So devotees are very fortunate. So we should be devotees, so we can also be happy and go back to Godhead. So after dressing nicely, Krishna and Balaram went to a florist of the name Sudana. So a florist is a man who sells flowers. So you have the tailor, the man who makes clothes, and then you have florist, that is the man who sells flowers. Or florist, or you can say the flower man. Flower man also means the man who sells the flowers. So as soon as they reached the precinct of his house, precinct means like the territory of his house. They went to his house, right? As soon as they went to his house, the florist immediately came out and with great devotion fell down to on his face to offer his respectful obeisances. So these florists were offering, dandavats to Krishna. He offered a nice seat, a nice chair to Krishna and Balaram, and asked his assistant to bring out flowers, betel nuts, and pulp of chandana. So he brought all these nice things to offer to Krishna. The florist welcome greatly satisfied the Lord. Krishna became happy with his florist also, because the florist was also a devotee and he also wanted to receive Krishna. So the florist very humbly and submissively offered to his prayers to the Lord. He was praying to the Lord. He was saying, "My Lord, my dear Lord, because you have come to my place, I think all my forefathers, no, all my ancestors, no, my father, my grandfather, my great grandfathers, and all my worshipable superiors are pleased and delivered. So, no, he said that because Krishna went to his house, all his family, all his ancestors, they were now free, they were liberated, they went back to Godhead because Krishna blessed him. So, my dear Lord, you are the supreme cause of all causes, right? Krishna is the creator of everything, of this cosmic manifestation, of this universe. But for the benefit of the residents of this earthly planet, you have appeared with your plenary portion, Balaram. Balaram is the plenary portion of Krishna, to give protection to your devotees and annihilate the demons. You are equally disposed as the friend of all living entities, right? Krishna is the friend of everyone. You are the super soul, and you do not discriminate between friend and enemy. Krishna gives mercy to everyone, right? To the friend and to the enemy. The washerman did not want to give the clothes to Krishna. He was the enemy of Krishna, and still he went back to Godhead, right? So, Krishna is merciful to everyone. Yet you are pleased to give your devotees the special result of their devotional activities. Krishna is pleased to bless the devotees. My Lord, I am praying that you please me. Tell me whatever you wish me to do, because I am your eternal servant. He said, Krishna, please tell me what I can do for you, what I can do to serve you. If you won't order me to do something, if you won't give me some order, it won't be a great favor to me. The florist Sudama was greatly pleased within his heart by seeing Krishna and Balarama in his place, in his house, and thus, as his choicest desire, as his deepest desire, his biggest desire, he made two exquisite garlands of various flowers and presented them to the Lord. So exquisite means like very wonderful, no, very big and opulent. This means exquisite. And he gave these garlands to the Lord. Krishna and Balaram were very much pleased with his sincere service. They were happy with this service, this offering, right? And Krishna offered the florist his salutation and benedictions. Krishna offered his blessings to this man, which he is always prepared to bestow upon the surrendered souls. Krishna is always ready, he's always prepared to give blessings, right, to his devotees, to anyone who surrenders unto him, right? So he gave his blessings to this flower man, to this florist. So when the florist was offered benedictions, he asked from the Lord that he might remain his eternal servant in devotional service, and by such service do good to all living creatures. So this florist, he asked the Lord to always remain his devotee, to always serve, to be able to always serve Krishna, and to do good to all living creatures, to be helpful, to help everyone. So by this, it is clear that the devotee of the Lord in Krishna consciousness should not be satisfied simply by his own advancement in devotional service. He must be willing to work for the welfare of others, right? A devotee should not be just happy by just advancing alone in Krishna consciousness. He must be wanting, he must be willing to help others to also advance spiritually. So that's a good devotee. This example was followed by the six Goswamis of Vrindavan. The six Goswamis of Vrindavan, they were doing like this. They were working for the benefit of everyone, right? So it is therefore stated in a prayer, in a song, a mantra about them, right? About the six Goswamis. The mantra is Lokananrita karino. Vaishnavas or devotees of the Lord are not selfish, right? The devotees, they are concerned about others. They want to help others. They are not just concerned about myself, my own advancement, right? So whatever benefits they derive from the Supreme Personality of Godhead as benedictions, they want to distribute to all other persons. So whatever the devotee get from Krishna, he wants to give to others, he wants to share with others. That is the greatest of all humanitarian activities, right? The devotee, he always wants to spread Krishna consciousness. He wants to share Krishna consciousness with other people. So this is the best help that you can give to people. This is the greatest of all humanitarian activities. Humanitarian activities means when you help other people. No, people are hungry, you give them prasada. People need clothes, you give them some clothes. This is humanitarian activities. So the best, the greatest of all humanitarian activities is to help people to become devotees of Krishna. That's the best. So being satisfied with the florist, Lord Krishna not only gave him whatever benedictions he wanted, but over and above that, no, Krishna not only gave all the blessings to this florist, but on top of that, you know, as an extra, no, as an addition, he offered him all material opulences, family prosperity, a long duration of life, no, and whatever else his heart desired within the material world. So he blessed this forest to become very opulent and have, you know, prosperity in his family and to have a very long life and whatever else he wanted. So that was the blessings of Krishna to this forest. So thus ends the Bhaktivedanta purport of the 41st chapter of Krishna. Krishna enters Mathura. So Haribo, Krishna is in Mathura now. Soon Krishna is going to fight with Kansa. Haribo. So there's going to be a lot of emotions in the next Saturdays with all these pastimes of Krishna in Mathura. Haribo. So thanks for coming and hearing this class. So I hope to see you again next Saturday. Hare Krishna. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Haribo.
Well, thank you
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, so
so much. Interesting chapter, and all glories to you also.
all glories to Srila Prabhupada. Hare Krishna, all glories to Guru Maharaj. Hare Krishna, so see you next Saturday. Hare Krishna.
Thank you for this class.
Thank you, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.